To engage perhaps more theoretically than we have in some senses through most of the conference, but also to pull together, to integrate some of the strands that we've discussed. And I know several people are thinking also some of the silences perhaps that we haven't discussed. So we've called this final round table, Disciplines, Perspectives and Theories from the South, Setting the African Studies Agenda. And the inspiration for this, I think, originated with Joost Fontaine when we started to plan the conference. And the idea of a round table was very much to provide different perspectives in a more interactive format than conventional papers, but crucially also to allow for discussion rather than just sort of traditional yes-no kind of questions and answers. So we have a fairly large panel. There are seven of us all together, and we're just waiting for one to arrive, Portia Kaja. I'm not quite sure whether she's still checking out or whatever, but we are all going to speak for no more than about 5 or 6 minutes, so that by 10 o'clock or so, we'll be able to open it up for discussion. And we will finish by 11 o'clock because there are taxis ordered, and if you have signed up on the list as per Jessica's instructions yesterday, a taxi will be available for you, and they'll be leaving from the foyer by about 11:30 or so. So just get your bags out of storage or wherever you have them, sort out any reimbursements or whatever that you're still needing to liaise with Jessica and colleagues about, and then be in the foyer. So this is the final session, and one way or another we'll finish by 11. So we're going to speak in the order that our names appear on the program, and I'll say a few words in a moment, and then Trevor Ngwane, who's a senior researcher and PhD candidate at the University of Johannesburg and long-standing activist, will start us off, to be followed by Cesar Cheelo, who is the Associate Executive Director of SciPower and also the Acting Executive Director of another think tank and policy institute, the Zambia Institute for Policy Analysis and Research. He in turn will be followed by Wheeler Winstead, who is Assistant Director of the Center for African Studies at Howard University in the US. And then Portia Kaja, representing the Progressive Teachers Union of Zimbabwe. And then Blessings Chinsinga, who is Deputy Director of the Center for Social Research and an Associate Professor in the Department of Political Industry Studies at Chancellor College at the University of Malawi. And then sitting nearest to me, Muna Ndulo, Professor of Law, and Elizabeth and Arthur Reich Professor, Leo and Arvila Berger International Legal Studies Program at Cornell University in the US, and is also on the Board of Directors of SciPower. And then finally, Patience Mususa from Department of Social Anthropology at UCT in Cape Town. So the topic, as I said, is broad. It's designed to be both provocative and also to enable us perhaps to end off this inaugural conference with some reflections in terms of how Southern African, or perhaps more broadly even African studies, can make a difference and start to rethink and to link up the rethinking with policy and praxis in ways that start to challenge the hegemonies, the neo-imperialisms and sub-imperialisms and all the other frames of reference and the geopolitics of resource extraction that in whatever form, be they bio-resources or mineral resources or human resources and environmental resources that we've talked about through all the sessions since lunchtime on Friday. And in a sense, the idea of theory from the South, even the framing of that is meant to be provocative, but it has created in recent years as much, I guess, negative reaction as it has positive inspiration. Because the irony is it's broadly framed within what we might call post-colonial studies, linking with post-traditionalism and... Portia, come and sit up here. And postmodernism in different ways, and various of the other post-structural frames of reference, all of which, despite their differences and the very diverse ways in which people taking those labels to describe their work have thought and have written and operate, what they share is that frustration that has been so clear through the conference with the traditional northern-centric conceptual and theoretical frameworks, and in the context, for example, of development, which is the area that I spend most of my time working in, the idea that many, but of course not all, of the dominant theories originate in the north, are linked to Western historical, economic, and other development trajectories, and with the rather simplistic assumption that the major difference between the OECD countries, or the global north, if you will, and those of the increasingly diverse global south are chronological time, and that countries in the south will emulate those dominant industrial-led paths to development which characterize the Industrial Revolution, post-industrialization, and all the rest. And of course, as we know, I think that's now commonplace and almost universally accepted outside the offices of a few of the international financial institutions and the regional development banks, is not how reality looks. And of course, reality in the singular is also something of oversimplification, because there are multiple realities, and that's precisely the point theoretically too. That what we have is multiplicities, we have pluralities, and increasingly the emphasis in the literature, whether it is post-colonialism or what Arturo Escobar initially coined as anti-development, but others, myself included, have suggested we need to distinguish anti-development, which is rejection of and resistance to those conventional northern-centric development trajectories and their ideological and theoretical underpinnings, and forms of post-development, which rather like post-colonialism, are not just chronologically post or after, but intellectually too. And again, the thread that seems to me is common to all these different perspectives and their numerous variants is the search for not a sort of singular modernist version of the truth, my theory is the only good one and yours are all lousy, but different worldviews, different perspectives, different knowledges, way of seeing and knowing the world, and therefore that indigenous communities, wherever they are, have much of value to offer and understand their own life experience, understand the environment within which they live, far better than a three-piece suited specialist agronomist or ecologist or industrialist from Washington or Geneva or London or Tokyo or Shanghai. And that's precisely the point. But the challenge, in many ways, is both to create something that is theoretically consistent and coherent while trying to hybridize, because of course many theoretical purists regard hybridization or eclecticism as something of an anathema in the first place, but in terms of translating those theoretical approaches into coherent policy and actual practice on the ground requires a complete change, not just to a theoretical position, but to the way we work. And I'll end my introduction by reflecting that the work that I'm doing at the moment as Director of Ministry of Urban Futures, in the context of urban sustainability, is trying to do just that. And it's undertaking what in many of the social sciences we call participatory methodologies, working with the people who are supposed to benefit from the interventions or whose lives and life worlds need changing, but doing it from the very beginning in terms of co-design, co-creation, joint research, co-production. And that, we find, provides the greatest likelihood that the outputs and the outcomes of such joint endeavors will actually be implemented and are likely to have meaningful impacts, precisely because the people who are responsible for implementing, who are also the people in many cases who will benefit and, as it were, have to live with the consequences of those interventions, have been part of the process from conception. It's not without its challenges, far from it. It's hugely challenging. It's very difficult, like participatory rural or urban appraisal and all the other such methodologies, because they are very time consuming, the outcomes are unpredictable, and the one thing I can say with huge confidence, it doesn't fit the neat log frames and project cycles of many funders and donor agencies, which insist on having the outcomes neatly logged, be they financial or the number of lives improved by whatever the intervention is supposed to have been, by the time that that final project report is submitted, by the time the agency's annual report has to go to the relevant ministry or the relevant international institution. So with those opening contextualizations, I'm going to ask Trevor to start us off. And if we can each keep to 5 or 6 minutes, probably better if people come up to the mic here, then we should have plenty of time for discussion.
Thank you very much. Yeah, so there is a global economic crisis. The rich are getting richer, the poor poorer. And I'm going to consider the strengths and weaknesses of theory from the South within this context. My question is, how does it contribute or potentially contribute to the struggle for the emancipation of humanity from what I consider the death throes of capitalism? So what are its political, social, and economic implications in relation to this crisis? What is its political content, its vision and strategy for social change? The crisis, just briefly, for me, I'll talk about three main dimensions of the crisis. Firstly, the economic crisis, which is a capitalist crisis. It's a rolling crisis, you know, it's moving. Hey, they can't solve it. The only debate is how to manage it. And as always, the capitalists, they try and make the weakest pay, bear the burden of the crisis. So it's the working class, it's poorer economies. Look what they're doing to Greece. So the question is, what does the theory for the, from the South say about this economic global crisis? The second point is the political crisis. I think neoliberal theorists or anti-neoliberal theorists have argued that neoliberalism hollows out democracy. So more and more it becomes clear that the state is the handmaiden of the bourgeoisie. We saw this clearly in South Africa with what we called the toxic collusion between the state and capital in the Marikana massacre. There is an ecological environmental crisis, climate change, carbon emissions, and we know that it is the capitalist system itself, its technologies, which is to blame, and the vested interests tied up with production linked to using fossil fuels become an obstacle to coming up with alternative energy sources. So what does the theory from the South say about this? Now, I think the theory from the South focuses on a fourth crisis, which is what I call an ideological cultural crisis, a meta-theoretical crisis. It's not just the ideas and the policies which are wrong, but it's the forms of knowledge, the building blocks, the epistemological assumptions which lie, which are the building blocks of the worldview and the economic and social practice. So it is a problem with knowledge itself. It is not only that the world is wrong, but it's how we see it, how we think about it, how we talk about it, how we theorize, how we write about it. So that's the thrust of the theory from the South. You know, it involves a critique of Eurocentrism, etc., etc. I won't go into that. But from this point of view, the theory from the South, it's a revolutionary challenge, you know, to what is going on. So in fact, it evokes a period. I know the post-colonialists don't like these analogies. It evokes a period in history where, you know, Marx and the young Hegelians were talking about a critique of everything existing. So it's not just this discipline, this theory, this country. Let us look at the fundamental, you know, philosophical, epistemological basis of what is wrong with society. So it is a revolutionary critique. But now we know that Marx talked about the relation between ideas and material circumstances. And he argued that, you know, the ideas don't just come from the head. It's because of real ferment, struggles on the ground, which actually create these different, generate these different ideas. So there's something in the world happening, and I think it is the crisis. It is the working class, the 99% against the 1%, the occupation movement, you know, workers, communities, peasants, rising up and saying enough is enough, which is generating. So to assess the theory of the South, I've just got 3 points. Firstly, on the grounds, on the sphere of agency. So since we're talking about China, I thought, hey, this theory seems to be geographically bounded, you know, the South, China, Africa, Latin America. And then we discussed yesterday, I think Patrick Bond talked about BRICS. Yeah, so there's a problem there then, because certainly it's not as if everything from the South is going to be good. And indeed, you know, China's intervention in Africa, for example, is not only debatable, I would argue, it's controversial. So, you know, agency is a big question. And then the second one is culture. Now, I think that for that kind of revolutionary challenge, you know, it cannot just be a debate in academic journals. You need an actual movement, you know, like the, you know, what was it, in the US, civil rights movement, okay? Yeah, so in South Africa, it's an example, there is such a movement in the universities by black youth. At UCT, University of Cape Town, where my friend Patience is, there's a Roads Must Fall movement campaign based on the theory of decolonization. So there was this big statue of Cecil John Rhodes, the imperialist, and they pulled it down. Okay, there's such a movement at University of Johannesburg, Black Thought at West University. Yeah. So, but what I noticed, especially at UCT, their form of decolonization theory takes a black separatist form, character. So, you know, it's black nationalism. For example, white students are not allowed in the meetings of this movement. Yeah. So, in a way, race, you know, is put above class in terms of the theory. And I noticed that, okay, these are students, so many of them have got what I can call petty bourgeois aspirations. So, there's no notion like during the days of Amilcar Cabral, you know, Kwame Nkrumah, there was this debate about the petty bourgeoisie must commit class suicide. So rather it is a self-righteous, aspirant petty bourgeois class thinking they are the leaders of the revolution and not really looking to the working class and the masses. So this is a problem. And then lastly, on the plane of revolution, I think that, you know, as I said about Marx, what we need is rupture. So what is rupture? It's actually the struggle to overthrow capitalism itself, okay? Yeah, so I think that, I don't know, the title of Komarov and Komarov's attitude is something about Euro-America evolving towards Africa. So I think that evolutionary perspective kind of jars with my idea of revolution. So I could be wrong, and I want to be wrong, because it could be that this is an idea whose time has come. This is how we used to talk in South Africa in the 70s, you know, during the student rebellion. And black consciousness is an idea whose time has come. So if it is, I think that it is progressive, I think, when race coincides with class. So if you go to Sandton in South Africa, to the restaurants, you know, it's just all white. You do feel, hey, if you go to the academia, all the professors are white. So you do feel that the youngsters have got a point, okay? Yeah, and then now the youngsters are demanding courses on Fanon. Yeah, so they've got a point where race coincides with class. But when the two diverge, it becomes more problematic and sometimes even potentially reactionary or taking us back. So my last words, therefore, is that we have to engage, you know, with the theory from the South, its subcategories, post-colonialism, decolonization theory, and engage with it comradely, you know, openly, and try and, you know, build the strengths, you know, try and maybe fight against those aspects we think don't take us forward. hey, Mandela was a great guy. I don't think he was so great in terms of economic policy. You know, he led us down the garden path, basically. But one thing he taught us was anti-racism. So he liberated us. So in a way, when students start talking about all whites are bad, you know, it is a step backwards. So those are the kind of things which are worrying. And then lastly, the future which we want for ourselves, for our children and our children's children, is a future where, you know, there'll be a place for everyone in the sun. Our vision is not only to liberate South Africa, Zambia, Africa, Latin America, but to liberate the whole world. We want to remove all forms of oppression, exploitation, you know, xenophobia, homophobia, you know, racism, not just in one place, but everywhere. And not just for one moment, but for all time. So if that is what will happen, or this is a platform to take us towards that vision, I will support the theory from the South. Thank you.
Morning, everyone. Let me start by saying I must confess that for me, having been the first time to attend a JSAS conference, this has been quite a learning experience. It's been an eye-opener, and I'm by no means an expert in theories from the South. My orientation is very much mainstream economics, so very sort of influenced by neoliberal training. And so maybe this will bring in a nice flavor of sort of controversy. Yeah. But no, really, I think it's been really interesting to learn and to hear about the different perspectives. I think sometimes, I mean, I had several pin moments in this conference, because sometimes with the haste, and by the way, I'm from a policy background, so the mix of an economist who's rushing to respond to policy demands and sort of forgetting your academic orientation, it's not a very good combination. So in that haste, sometimes we tend to not take time to think through what we're learning, what we're teaching, and to also be critical. So for me, that was one of the big take homes is I think there's a huge role for academics to play in always reminding society, the rest of us, about critically thinking through what messages we're accepting, as well as what messages. I used to teach at the university before, and in many points of this conference, I kept asking myself, was I teaching with the right lens, and did I learn with the right lens? I mean, in economics, a simple but I think fundamental assumption, if you look at microeconomics, is that the firm is primarily assumed to be in the business for profit. And in many ways now, I'm actually starting to question, is this always the motive of the firm? Is it to always make profit? Should it always be like this? At the end of the day, whether you are sort of from the left, in the middle, from the right, I think the main take home for me is we do need to think critically about these things, about how our disciplines have been formulated, the theoretical basis of our disciplines, and start to question whether they should be rethought, whether they can be a bit more balanced, alternative views about how we should look at the world. And I think in that respect, trying to get as much space as we can for alternative thinking is going to be important. If we think about, for example, the amount of lead time that some of the more popular sort of northern theories have had. I was just saying I'm heavily influenced by that, and a conference such as this one would maybe be just a first step in trying to revise the thinking in some ways or others and change things. So a small sort of critique now on academics and the way we do things is, I think as we try to buy space for our alternative approaches, like I said, whether you are from the left, in the middle, or on the right, I think we do need to realize that we're just not at the front line of creating new knowledge, of refining the thinking, of pushing forward theory. But we have to start thinking in terms of being an engine for society to draw on ourselves. I think in many ways, academics tend to talk to themselves and not really create the linkages with the rest of society and actually pull society along to become sort of knowledge-based and informed, to think critically. I mean, there's no chance that society will take our jobs away from us. I think we are really advanced in critical thinking. But I think coming from a perspective like mine, somebody who is sort of policy oriented in the work that I do, I see strong possibilities if we can find ways of connecting all the rich thinking, all the rich theory, all the research that I've heard in the past 3 or 4 days, in a bit of a stronger way with society. I know my field in terms of policy analysis would benefit a great deal. I think NGOs, some of whom are here, benefit a great deal from these things. Lawmakers, also Guy Scott was here and he said something yesterday about, we are looking for answers from you guys. And that's, I think that that's an important element to think about. I think there's promise. I'm not saying it's all been bad and we've been insulated as academics and have not done anything. JSAS, I think, is a clear example of steps in the right direction. I think the model of connecting universities to think tanks and think tanks to the rest of society holds a lot of promise for translating some of the rich knowledge that we have, conveying it to society. And I think the mixing of disciplines is another, I think, really great step in the right direction in teasing out and getting people to think outside their small boxes or small spaces and be more receptive or open-minded to accepting or thinking critically about different perspectives, different ways of doing things. I think it's been a roller coaster with a lot of learning, a lot of information. And I really look forward to the future of JSAS for all of us. And I hope that some of what I have said would filter into the way JSAS and the way academics, we tend to do things in terms of trying to be more connected with the rest of society. Thank you.
Wheeler. So good morning, everyone. My approach on this is probably a little different than the other two speakers. I am going to do a critique of us. And I'm gonna use the context that was given us, who should set the intellectual agenda for African studies? Who should set the intellectual agenda for African studies. And when I first thought about this, I said, well, this sounds a little rhetorical. I mean, if I ask the question, who should set the intellectual agenda for European women? I say, European women. You're not going to say African men. But I think the fact that we ask the question speaks to the problem. Because the agenda setting speaks to, well, intellectual agendas represent national agendas, i.e. Rudyard Kipling's White Man's Burden. But also, the agenda setting depends on the audience you want to speak to. For example, in America, if you ask who should set the agenda for, intellectual agenda for African studies, you might expect Americans. If you were in Europe and you ask who should set the intellectual agenda for African studies, you might expect Europeans, because there's, the audience is European, and it would be reflecting the agenda of that particular nation state, because that agenda is going to carry out whatever the agenda of that nation is. And we have to admit that we asked this question because in Africa, African intellectuals are not setting the agenda in the intellectual market, which is often global published items and conferences. And I have to even ask that same question as I look around at us. Now, maybe to help us understand this, I thought, well, could this happen in China? Could we be in China asking who should set the intellectual agenda for China and have mostly Westerners? I think we would say no. This could not happen in China. A meeting, even as wonderful as this, could not and would not happen in China. But why does it happen in Africa? And again, I think I'm preaching to the choir because I think most of you understand this, but I think we need to understand our own culpability and responsibility in this. Why in Africa? Because of the power dynamics, military, economic, and financial, and basically he who has the gold rules by setting the agenda. And since Africans lack the military, economic, financial power, it is set by those of us who are privileged from Western and European societies, who have wealthy economies and beneficiary universities enriched by stolen African riches. And our African counterparts are marginalized by virtue of our control of the global intellectual market, i.e. publication venues. So this is the message to us. We need to acknowledge our advantage and privilege and how hypocritical and possibly arrogant we may sound to our African peers and be open to their criticism. We, as brothers and sisters of the world, must be willing to voluntarily subordinate our opinion to our African peers, offering them collegial suggestions. I believe we are making steps in the right direction. I think it's evidence here. However, we have a long way to go. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. want to speak from the layman's point of view rather than the intellectual. When you look at the agenda of Africa, in most cases, it's not the Africans that set the agenda. You are looking for funding, that's the key point. When you're looking for funding, it comes with strings attached to it. And you don't get to contribute to the conditions of that funding. So it's like in Zimbabwe, for example, that's where I come from. When we're looking for, the government was looking for funding to pay the civil servants, to pay people out there, well, the working class. So it had to go to the IMF, look for money from the IMF. But then the IMF says you have to cut the wage bill, you have to cut the civil service. So it means the poor are getting poorer and the rich are getting richer. Because when the wage bill is cut, it means someone is going to lose their job. Someone is going to, how are they going to fend for their families? That's how they want it to be. Because you cannot cut the salary from someone, but you're just going to cut the jobs. We're also looking at the, there are some things like, remember in 2009, if not 2010, when the government of national unity was in place, that at that time there was a controversy in the election outcomes, and the MDC thought it had won, and the ZANU-PF also had to hide the results from them. But then what happened during that period, from the time we went to vote and the time we ended, we came up with the GNU, there was this talk of China providing arms. And I remember very well the ship was called the Ngwane. I remember that, and it got to people's nerves. When you wonder, that kind of equipment, when it's coming into the country, to us as workers and the poor, it looks like we are saying the Chinese need something from Zimbabwe in return for the ammunition. And how do they get their money from to pay back from there? It's also through the workers and the poor. They raise fees maybe in universities, give a little bit to the government coffers, also raise bills, water bills, electricity bills. It all comes to the layman, to the general populace. That's where the bills are put there in order to cover for whatever they want. Now you see again, the Supreme Court ruling that's in Zimbabwe at this moment, it is saying that workers can be laid off without any package after being given 3 months notice. You can just be laid off after serving even for the greater part of your life. You can just be laid off without being given any package. When you look at that again, we see, I'm sorry to continue talking about the Chinese, but that's how they are perceived in Zimbabwe by the working class and the general public. They are saying it's because the vice president has been going up and down China, having talks, business talks with the Chinese, and as soon as he returns, there's this High Court ruling, that the Supreme Court ruling, that says one can be laid off without any package. So to us it means they want to casualize labor so that we do not have a say. You do not even go on strike, you can't go on maternity leave because you're afraid when you come back you find you've lost your job already, and there's no law that says you can keep your job after that. So it's like everything that is being done in Zimbabwe is like it's being dictated by some foreign nations, foreign people, foreign donors or stuff like that. So it's like we are saying as workers and the general public, we need to do our own things, and we need the government to give us an opportunity to say what we think is right for us. Because in most cases, when the government thinks for the people and goes and into deals for the people, they say they are representing the people, but then the burden obviously comes back to the people. So we are saying the African agenda in general should be set by the Africans. That's what I think, but then that's not how it's happening now. Those that have the funding, those that have the money, those that have the resources are the ones that are setting things for us. And I think we need to say enough is enough to that. Thank you.
Blessings.
We'll focus mainly on the challenges of Africa taking the lead in setting the pace of African studies. And as you all know, our contributions are drawing from the very difficult book to read by the Comaroffs. Yeah. And the central message coming out of this book is that I think academics, especially from the South, have to get out of their comfort zones and become producers of social theory that can actually benefit their own people. That's the basic central message coming from this book. And because of this, this book is a great source of inspiration to most people from the South. Yeah. And this inspiration is based on two central themes of the book. The first one is that there is no one single modernity. Yeah. There are possibilities of modernities. In other words, the modernity that can be experienced in the South is not a derivative of modernity experienced in Europe or America, which basically gives hope that people from the South can actually drive their own social political theory. The second one is that given what is happening in the global context, the global South is at the front end of contemporary history. Mm. Yeah. Because whatever is happening in the global North is being exported back from here to the global North. The reason is very simple, and this has to do with the history. The history has been that the global North has been using the global South to experiment with various things. Yeah. And the argument is that because of that, the global South is overtaking the global North in terms of the tangible lived experiences that are now being exported back to the global North. So on that basis, the argument that is being advanced is that the global South is now in a better position to produce its own theory. And what these two authors do is to invite us as scholars from the South to make things that have been familiar to be different, to make the settled look strange. So basically, inviting us to use the opportunity brought about by these changes in the global configuration, especially of capitalism, to theorize. And what I like most is their, I think, edge, saying that in order to do that requires courage and determination. You cannot do it if you're not determined, if you're not
are courageous. So what I like most about the book is that the book is very optimistic.
Yeah.
That things can change. But my argument really is that this optimism is misplaced.
Yeah.
It's misplaced because of one major reason. Yes, the Global South is being used for experimentation of various things, and these are being exported back and informing, I think, livelihoods in the North. But in this case, the key question really is whose ideas are these of the things that are being experimented in the Global South? And you will discover that these ideas are from the Global North. So on that basis, I find the optimism expressed in this book as being misplaced. And I think even the emergence of the BRICS does need nothing to change the situation. So my argument is that if this is simply a passing phase of optimism for the possibilities of developing theories from the Global South. But what I really want to stress in my contribution is basically the challenges. Yeah. What are the challenges that we face as scholars in the Global South to make a meaningful contribution to the development of social theory? And I have, I think, four main points that I really want to share. The first one is the previous incentive structures for academics to be producers of knowledge, or indeed social theory. My observation is that most academics in the South, probably, I mean, with the exception to some degree of South Africa, publish for the sake of getting up the career ladder, and not necessarily for knowledge itself. The idea is very simple. You publish because if you get promoted, it means your take-home income increases. So the moment you become professor, there is no age to publish anymore. In fact, I can argue here without fear or favor that most of the professors that I know have essentially privatized themselves. They no longer produce knowledge for the broader common good. They are busy jumping from one consultancy to another. And that cannot help to engage with our partners from the North meaningfully. Yeah, because what has happened, therefore, is that academics move where there's money. Yeah, they follow money, and they don't follow knowledge. Yeah. So the implication is that there is a very big trade-off between depth and breadth. I think African scholars are very good in terms of breadth, but very bad in terms of depth. And you require depth in order to make a meaningful contribution to the production of knowledge. The second point is the poor research infrastructure, which has basically turned most universities, I think, in the region into teaching universities. Yeah. They are not research universities. I mean, the time I was joining the University of Malawi in 1996, there used to be small funds for upcoming academics so that they can be initiated into the reach of research. But those funds have completely dried up. And what makes the situation even more challenging is that the publication outlets within the continent are almost non-existent. Yeah. Most of the outlets are outside Africa, to the extent that our work is readily available in the North than it is readily available within the region. And without building such a stock of knowledge, it will be very difficult for us to seize the moment. The third challenge is what I call a historically embedded suspicious relationship between academics and their governments. You see, in order for you to make a meaningful contribution to theory, you need to think outside the box. And most governments in this region are not comfortable with people who think outside the box. And that is a huge hindrance, because it constrains the kind of academic enterprise that one can engage in. I mean, I can tell of my own personal story. I mean, a simple lecture ended up paralyzing the university for 9 months. Mm. You can't work in that environment in order to produce the knowledge that would be competitive globally. So what I would say is that we need probably a new kind of political settlement in most countries within the region if we are to create an enabling environment in which academics can meaningfully pursue grand noise academic enterprises. And finally, I think the neo-colonial oriented development agenda at the continental level doesn't help at all, because it lobs academics on the continent the opportunity to make tangible contributions. I think most of the initiatives championed by the African Union are touted as African-driven, but in reality they are not. You look at NEPAD, that hardly be called an African initiative, because the brains behind that were hardly African. Mm. You look at CADAP, that is an opportunity for scholars on the continent to make meaningful contributions. But if you look at who have actually designed CADAP, not many Africans. Sometimes, I mean, I've been to several CADAP platforms, you find that they are more outsiders than Africans. And yet, that is supposed to be an African-driven agenda. This is not to say that there's no benefit in a cross-federalization of knowledge, but this speaks to the whole idea of understanding what would create an atmosphere in which Africa, African intellectuals would make a tangible contribution. I think if you compare these two initiatives with the other typically African initiatives, you will discover that the typical African initiatives haven't really succeeded, haven't really been given the support that they require. For instance, the African Renaissance, that was something that we can call typically African, but it has been trampled. So basically, I would like to conclude that while this book by the Comaroffs is very, very inspiring in terms of the possibilities that it offers, in terms of people from the South detecting their intellectual enterprises, the challenge is that there is a political economy that is not very favorable to ensure that that happens. Thank you very much for that.
Thank you. Good morning, everyone. Yeah, thank you very much for this opportunity to reflect on the conference. But first, I think I must really thank David, and Alistair and Maya for inviting me here. I really appreciate it. I think, like Caesar, I find myself of course, a community that's very different from the one I work in. I'm basically a very simple lawyer, so we spend lots of our time in a very different kind of framework. But what I thought I would do then is that I would reflect on my experiences working for the UN trade agency, because I took time off from academia and worked for the UN full-time for 9 years in Austria, Vienna, and we were in charge of trade laws. So what I would like to do then is look at really the cluster of external, what are the clusters of external impact? Because I think as you research the agenda for the South, one must be aware of what the these clusters are and what they're doing. I think the current process of globalization appears inimical to the expression of the form of solidarity and North-South debates in the era of development, as well as to the global expansion of forms of solidarity that dominate within the national space. We are all clear that one characteristic of globalization is the multiplication of relations between individuals and between organizations across national borders. I think in order to account for justice in these relations, or to explain the new form of solidarity that they stimulate, and in this basis to build a vision of global justice and global solidarity, we must move towards innovative approaches, because we do need really new approaches to deal with what we have. Now, the channels, I think there are basically three channels of external impact. And these are important as they reduce the national space. Globalization is characterized by, of course, as we already said, by increased movement of goods, capital, etc. Now, the question really is, what are the ways in which the North impact on the rest of the world? And what institutions do they use to impact on that? And I think there are basically three institutions that are used from my experience I had in working on trade issues. That is the multilateral organizations. And then, of course, foreign aid and development cooperation policies. And the external impact of the internal policies. I think we forget that sometimes what impacts the South is not necessarily the international activity, but very, very domestic policies of Western countries can have tremendous impact on actually the South. Now, looking at macro organizations, you find that each multilateral organization, of course, has a specific role, and you'll find that they impact tremendously on national states. Until the 1970s, I think what we saw was that most of these organizations were either forums for the provision of what we could call public goods. And e.g., they would develop international standards, and they would be doing things like that. But in fact, and in their discussions in those early days, the basic principle underlying the multilateral organizations were really the national sovereignty, the state. So I think that is expressed, for example, within the context of the United Nations in terms of one state, one vote. But over the last 20 years, we've seen a major transformation in the landscape of these multilateral organizations. And this has been the increasing influence or three of them over the organization of some of the countries within which they operate. And these are basically the three, the IMF, World Bank, and WTO. And they each play a very different role in terms of the globalization. And I'll try to get into that in the limited time that I have. So the role of the IMF and World Bank increased significantly in the aftermath of the debt crisis. And we, of course, they became extremely powerful, and we see that begin to get engaged in reform programs and that sort of thing. Now, the global character of the World Bank and the IMF reside in the expression of their activities globally. Now, and they're contained within the belief that there's just one set of adequate developmental policies. I mean, they are focused on simply one policy. Like they are the right, they know the right policies, and then they try to push these policies. Now, we find that once a country, for example, is hit by severe macroeconomic or political crisis, you find that they are there to intervene. Of course, the latest example is Greece. And you find that when you require international assistance, there is always a set policy framework within which they respond to that crisis. So what you see then, of course, is that the national sovereigns are formally, are supposed to be a national, but in practice, they are greatly screwed by lack of choice, that you don't actually have much choice because of the structure of the international system. Now, I think that when we look at as I said, they tend to, advocate one type of policy. So of course, what this really means is that you're having a situation where the economic policies are being regarded as being set at an international level with a very limited role being played by national states. Now, I said there are three organizations, and I'm trying to explain how each one of them operates in this context of globalization. Now, if you take WTO, unlike the World Bank and the IMF, the global character of the WTO actually resides not in its policies, and I think you must be aware of that, because it's actually in the institutional design that makes them very powerful. So one of the key factors, of course, of this is that it is where they make decisions in terms of agreeing on binding rules. So it's more the forum that is there. And what we see is that in WTO, you have a situation where the discussions are never really in the formal meetings. They're always in informal groups. And these informal groups arrive at decisions which are then imposed on the rest of the countries. So the process, as when you look at it, subordinates an important national policy tool for southern countries. That is the trade policy. So we find that the trade policy is actually subjected to this structure. And it's never, if you look at the way WTO functions, it's never in these big meetings. The big meetings is usually simply to adopt what really was concluded in small groups that they are meeting. And I think it's this aspect that qualifies the WTO as a global organization. In fact, many people see WTO as actually being there to to underpin the control of corporations over the world. Now, if you look at the World Bank, on the other hand, it's a mandate is of course that it comes in to sort of like deal with the problems that are being created by globalization. So its projects are basically poverty alleviation and this kind of thing. And if you look at the IMF, IMF is there to kind of like try to focus on the discipline, the trying to micro-discipline in terms of the economy and all that. So I think that what you see then is that the WTO is there to facilitate the continuation and institutionalization of trade liberalization. And then the IMF to ensure overall macroeconomic activity. And then the World Bank to manage the problems created by the system. So now, and I think, as I said, we also have to be aware that there are a lot of internal policies that are carried out by countries that have an impact on the South, that have nothing to do with actually being imposed by the IMF. And here I'll give examples, for example, in terms of the US, you know, the whole question of their agricultural policy, you know, has tremendous impact on the world. But it's essentially a matter that is handled by the US Congress, and that's nothing to do with anybody else. You also have to look at, you know, things like OPIC in terms of insurance. No American firm, no major American firm goes abroad and invest without American insurance. I mean, they do that. And if you look at the terms of the insurance, there's subrogation, there's all kinds of things which ensure that, in fact, the burden, if there's failure, is actually on the southern state. So then I think what this means is that I think as we discuss questions of justice at the international level, as I say, we have to be innovative, and I think we have to follow what Amati said, I think, recommends, which is that we should pose the issue of justice and fairness in several distinct, though interrelated, domains involving various groups that can cross national boundaries. We should not look at this as the same in every sphere of our public activity. So this would mean that in each sphere we develop different criteria. And I think the injustice that is perpetrated is trying to apply the same criteria to every situation. And I think that actually doesn't work. Now, I think in conclusion, I'd like to comment on the research. I think I completely identify myself with what the last speaker said in terms of the shortcomings of research in African universities. But I think I'd also like to identify with what Professor Lee said yesterday, that as we research these issues, we must have comparative approaches. Because I was intrigued looking at you know, the discussions on China, for example, that we assume, for example, that the greatest investment of China in the world are actually in Africa. And if you look at IMF reports, you'll find that the investment in Africa by China is exactly the same as in one country in South America, Brazil. So then you begin to realize that, you know, these things, you know, you do need to look at it in a comparative manner so that you can understand what really the dimensions are. And also the question of Africa exporting, for example, you know, raw materials to China. But Africa exports raw materials to every country. I don't think there's a single country which Africa trades, and because the matter is one of lack of industrialization. So the focus should be, how do we achieve industrialization in Africa? For example, Zambia exports copper to China. So does it, when it exports to Korea, to anyone? I'm not aware that Zambia is actually exporting any manufactured goods to any country. So I think these comparative approaches are very important to inform our discussions. And I think also we should not forget that the South is making a contribution to the world, and I think we need to articulate those things. For instance, in my own field, in constitutional making, we find that, you know, the South African process has really made tremendous impact on the world. When we work in Afghanistan, I was in Afghanistan, and you know, we were using the examples from South Africa. I just came back from Colombia 2 weeks ago, and the discussions on, you know, the talks with the FARC, in terms of what to do with the past, they are in fact looking at the best practices from South Africa. So I think that sometimes we also fail to articulate what the South is actually contributing to the world in terms of knowledge. And lastly, I think as we, again coming back to the question of research, I think, for example, African scholars are big on talking about integration all the time. But really, when you look at it, if you study, again, if you take the comparative approach, you will see that integration programs that have succeeded are those that are from the bottom, not from the top. You know, the AU leaders meeting and saying that you're going to form SADC or whatever. The point is that there's no incentive to integrate, actually, in Africa. What does Zambia say to Malawi? There's nothing. So, of course, there's no incentive. You have to create the incentive before, in fact, integration can come to play. So I think my time is up, but I hope that I've been able to share some of my views about the research and also the clusters that actually impact on domestic policies in the South. Thank you.
Thank you. I think what is striking about the Comaroff's book is that they have asked us to think, and in particular the kind of classic North-South divide is not as neat as we have oftentimes referred to used it in academic circles. And they are, in a way, I feel, kind of asking us, by looking towards the South and what's happening there, to start thinking about what the experience is of living within a world where, I would argue, kind of fundamentalist, speculative capital has come to dominate, and how to survive in those kinds of conditions of marginality and begin to kind of question from a theoretical perspective the classic ways in which we have and done work between pretty much, you know, what happens on the ground and how you theorize about it in terms of structure. So they what the attempt is to pretty much recuperate what's the initiatives and impotences of what's happening this end. And I would argue to say that from my own work, that theoretical perspectives and kind of thinking about the nature of experience and existence within the South, as the Comaroffs do in the various cases and ethnographies they provide in their book, is in spaces outside the academy largely. It's in the initiatives of the lived experience, it's in kind of the kinds of speculative little markets that kind of appear on the side, it's in understanding notions of personhood and the like. And what they do is that they draw on several kind of classic tensions in academia, for example, between practice and discourse. What are people doing and what are people saying? And then also the tension between space and place. You know, space is that kind of imaginary territoriality and place where there's the lived experience. So how do you merge and kind of think between the two? And then there's also the issue of trajectory, which in a way they fall within the same trap of. So, and it falls within this kind of notion of modernity, and they talk about multiple modernities, but then the question is the North evolving towards the South? And they talk about it in a way as a race and all. And is it really a race, or as they argue in other parts of the book, is it a way, what one would argue, a kind of multiplicity in options for living within context where the opportunities for life are being eroded by an erosion of welfare and the like. And they draw on links and connections, again, to kind of remind us that we live in a shared world. So they draw on the work, for example, that, so on one hand, they talk about links and vectors, but then at the same time, they talk about flows. And to kind of show how one could, at the same time, kind of map these interconnections, but then other times these interconnections elude us, because they move beyond easily mappable routes. And then they also argue to say that rather than a focus on structure, we should also be looking towards events, kind of the analysis of events, and a way of trying to kind of capture a confluence of, flows and interconnections that highlight certain or specific relations that exist within the capitalist world. And what they begin to speak to is also this notion of the everyday life, and they speak about biopolitics, which I feel they do not go far enough, especially in kind of thinking about the context, kind of illuminated by the various panel makers, about what happens when the basis for welfare, we think about the Greek crisis and all else, following kind of Facebook discussions, and how similar discussions about the Greek crisis, conversations about Zambian austerity, Zimbabwean austerity are very, very similar across the world. So what is the nature of experience in this shared world, and how do we begin to think about it that goes beyond our regular analytical categories? How do we bring back the notion of the body within that? And I think when the Comoros speak about personhood, I feel they do not go far enough in conceptualizing what it is that the body needs to be able to go on living and making possibilities for life within these kinds of settings. So even though they kind of highlight all the kind of possibilities that are happening on the continent, they do not go far enough, I feel, in kind of drawing on the materiality that's needed to stretch out life in its broader sense. So what I would argue, I would say kind of my strongest critique is that I think we should move towards a kind of much more, Tim Ingold, right, anthropologist, writes about it, in a way kind of biosocial becomings, but one that draws in the ecological. If we have to think about shared resources, climate change, welfare, and the like, and in a way a kind of drawing on the Comoroffs, this notion to say, where do we look to the possibilities of being able to create this within a context where speculative capital is eroding it. Thank you. Thank you.
Well, I promised heterogeneity, possibly tension, diversity, hybridity. I don't know how much of that we've had, although we ended up with a plea for more of that in a particular context. Maybe that is precisely the note on which to open it up for general discussion. Leo first, and then Wapu, and then Joost. And we have a roving mic. If somebody could rove with it, that would be extremely helpful.
Thank you. Hello.
The green light.
Is on.
Hello. Yeah, you're there.
I found that absolutely fascinating panel, which has huge numbers of insights for all of us. I found the experience spending some years during and after the crisis, the global economic crisis in Europe, an absolutely haunting and fascinating experience. Haunting because it seemed to me that what was being advocated and to some extent pushed in an exceptionally aggressive way was a series of structural adjustment programs on a continental scale, which to some extent reflected the experience of adjustment that had taken place on the continent in the 80s and the 1990s. So I think the sense of the Comaroff's books as speaking to that moment at which the South comes North is incredibly real and also exceptionally important, because I think at its heart, and it's missing to some extent from the book, is a question of resistance and struggle. And in those countries that resisted hardest, and Greece of course is one of those case studies, the institutions of that adjustment the IMF and the European Union, came down as incredibly tough programs of adjustment on that resistance. But if you look at Ireland, for example, that had debt levels which were almost equivalent to Greece, but also accepted the adjustment, the comparison is incredibly powerful. But for me, what's interesting is that the sense of the South coming North is incredibly powerful, but also the lessons of the South, and the lessons, of course, of that period of adjustment from the 1980s to the 1990s, and what that can teach the rest of the world. And I think the period, not just of African uprisings that was discussed yesterday, to some extent I'm interested in those uprisings, but I think that we need to demand of them a question of the weaknesses of the political movements that emerged during that anti-ESAP period from the 80s and the 90s and the early 2000s. Why were those movements, which were extraordinary, that were described in various ways as an epoch of uprisings, not able to sustain political struggle, were not able fundamentally of reversing that adjustment which took place on a continental scale and to devastating effect? And we've been talking about that to some extent. I think now has to be an opportunity to start asking those hard questions about, in this period of uprising that Patrick mentioned elusively yesterday, what are the deeper questions of organisation, of structure, of political ideas that confront progressive movements? So this is really my question to the panel. What is the challenge to organisation and politics and of the progressive left in this period of African uprising? How do the organisations and the agency of those movements need to be shaped to make the possibilities real, not lost to some extent as they were in that period of the 80s and the 1990s? And I just have a question for the conference. I think it's also a period of serious reflection in the broader period of the collapse of the Washington consensus. And I picked this up, I think, in discussions that we've had here about the role of the Soviet Union. If you like, an almost nostalgia for the old models of state-led Soviet solidarity and development. I think that this period of reflection, and this perhaps is an agenda for a future conference, but has to start unpicking those old models, how they didn't work, how they were almost a socialism without active working class or popular agency. So we need to unpick the nostalgia that comes about in the broader story of the collapse of the Washington consensus.
Great, thanks. Can we just pass this back maybe to Joost first and then back to Wark, simply in terms of the logistics?
Okay, that's working. I just want to make a comment, really, about theories from the South and what it offers this conference and what we should be thinking about. Because I don't think Theory from the South, that book, is really just a critique of the old argument that the South is somehow stuck in some evolutionary bound to the North. I don't think that book is just about that. It's not just an argument for us to recognize how the Southern origins of the theoretical tools that we use. In other words, there is an important point here. A lot of the theoretical tools that we use did not simply derive from the so-called North. They actually derived from research that was done in the South. Okay? So there's a new book on archaeology that's making this point. And I think that's a very important point. All right, so the theoretical tools we use derive from, in part, work done in the so-called South. But I think Theories from the South is trying to say something more than that. It's not just an argument for pointing to how the South repeats or leads the North. Again, it's an important point. To think about structural adjustment and austerity. In many respects, the new politics of austerity that's taking place in the North was already took place in the South as a result of the ESAPs. That's a really important point to bear in mind. But again, I think Theories from the South is trying to say something more than that. Because when they talk about the South, they talk about the South as a concrete abstraction, right? In other words, an idea that does something in the world. So the question then is, what does the idea of a world divided along a North-South axis do in the world? What does it enable? What does it constrain? Therefore, theory from the South is not just an attempt to reverse a teleology, is a difficult word, a spatiality or a temporality. Theory from the South is also a call to arms to rethink the very terms of our intellectual engagement beyond such a North-South axis. Right? So, in whatever directionality or temporality you want to put that into. In other words, theory from the South is a call for us to rethink the temporal and spatial scheme through which we divide the world in our thinking. Can we rethink the world in a way that doesn't depend upon a North-South axis, right? In other words, can we set free another concrete abstraction to do something different in the world? And I think that's the real theoretical challenge that this book gives us, and that also links directly to the theme of this conference. And that's how really what I think we should be thinking about.
Thanks. Marco?
Okay, thank you very much to all of you for the presentations. I have two specific questions, and the first one is that in light of globalization, what do you see as the role of the diaspora in terms of knowledge generation? And that sometimes it depends, the boundaries get blurred, where you do have people coming from, originally from Africa, working in northern universities. And you see those as also contributing to the production of knowledge and theories. Secondly, I think Blessings and Muna lamented the African university. Do you see the current African university as being relevant in terms of production of theories? I think that a lot has happened and we seem to have lost kind of direction. Should we be thinking of setting up maybe different centers which could be helpful in terms of production of knowledge? Thank you.
Thanks. And if you then just pass it over to the other side of the room. Thanks, Mike. Go for it.
I have two questions. First, it's a comment and a question. I think it's very important, even in our circles, to be honest and not be evasive and declare our ideological inclinations in terms of how we frame the agenda setting. I'm speaking to this because I get a sense that in the broader scheme of things, there's a state of gridlock, and we need to be honest about that. Gridlock. In a sense, we're not saying the same things. When we're talking about setting the agenda for the South, it cannot be set by Europeans. It has to be a clear way. The reason why we want to say that theories from the South should be at the center of the world is that people understand themselves on their own terms and not as defined by other people. It has to be made clear. And I think in doing so, then we can actually begin to look at the alternatives, the possibilities that exist in that in a world that we want to imagine. Now, following that, I just want to ask a question to the panel. What are the thoughts around what curricula do we teach in setting a new agenda? There are different contestations. If we look at
people like Kefa Molefa Sante, Nabuderes, Achi Mafeje, Louis Sarah Gordon, people speak about the concept, and I'm not talking about the global south in general, I'm talking about Africa, or what they say, Africologists, Africanity. What do we teach when there's also these contestations that exist?
Okay, thanks very much. And Cheryl, right behind you.
And so just the point that I'm wanting to make is, I think we should not only be looking at theories as something that are in some way pre-given, but processes of theory building. And in doing that, we have to be thinking about methodologies as well. And so I think thinking more about research methodologies, and we've had some discussions about ethnography and different kinds of sources of the data, et cetera, but how we actually think about kinds of research, the methodologies we employ, and not only theory as some kind of abstraction almost. That would be the point that I wanted to make.
Great, thanks. Let's zigzag back to the front here, so hand over there, and then how is it? Yeah.
So, I'm a bit uneasy about the entire discussion. We're trying to put this into a provocative stance, of which I'm not sure if I'm correct or not, but it might help the discussion. So being serious from this house is, in a way, liberal in the old pejorative sense. It tries to supplement a fat conscience by declaring oneself in the lead of progressive moment, but without giving up the privilege attached to one's own position. And in the panel, in the audience now, as someone attempted to convert this into a progressive argument by framing political economy back then. But is this not just another way of avoiding the real question? What do we do about the fact that we are part of the inequalities and keep them alive? And I don't have the answer to that question.
Thanks very much. And then forward to Carol.
A quick question. Why are scholars of Africa ignoring the practices on the ground among the smallholder farmers in organizing around genetic resources? Their practices are ahead of theory, and we're not paying attention.
Thank you. First, Comrade Trevor, Rose did not fall. Rose was lifted. You know.
Are you suggesting he has risen?
Yeah, you might reappear, resurface. I got photographs here. just want to pick up on the point that Leo made about the lessons that we can learn from the Soviet-Russian experience. And would like to add that when we sort of to focus now on those debates, we should not forget now that there is a prior debate now that could be, you know, important now in terms of the issues that we're talking about here. And that's the debate, you know, involving Lenin, Trotsky, and Stalin around the international character of the revolution and the possibility whether it was possible now for socialism to be built in one country. We know that, of course, you know, Stalin no one the debate, and maybe, you know, some of what became of the Soviet Union is a consequence now of those debates. So it's not Stalinism that needs to be assessed, but it's also not sort of the process that led to the rise of Stalinism. And I think that, you know, that would have valuable, you know, lessons, you know, for us, you know, especially those of us, you know, who look at the South as something that, you know, is, you know, that is juxtaposed, you know, with the North, with the North. And the question then, you know, is whether or not it is possible for us, you know, to, you know, to, in the South, to liberate, you know, us, ourselves, in without considering what happens in the North. My sense is that there are good girls, good guys in the South, just as there are good girls and good guys in the North. And maybe, you know, sort of, you know, the thing that we may consider would be to try and identify the good guys in the South and the North, and perform alliances against the good guys and girls in the South and the North. Thanks.
Great, thanks very much. Time for one or two more before the panel sums up. Okay, I'll leave it right back to the other corner, please.
Thank you very much for the thought-provoking presentation of the panel. Just want to develop an argument from Caesar's confession that he was trained as a neoliberal economist. And I thought that was one of the important points that you made by the panel. The question of how we are formed as researchers, as intellectuals, whether we're in the South or whether we're in the North. But sometimes we make the presumption that the intellectual in the South stands outside the social, social, and other processes of the production of the intellectual. And thus the question should shift really to how we unlearn forms of knowledge that have formed us indirectly. I think that's the key if we are going to move forward. For instance, I studied at the University of Malawi, and what I studied was Western theory. But I was in the South. I grew up at the University of Malawi. What I was teaching was Western knowledge. I'm now in London. What I teach mostly is Western knowledge. So in fact, I haven't changed. When I was in Malawi, now in London, I'm still immersed in a certain kind of intellectual education. So the key question is, for me, is how do I unlearn what I've learned and the way in which what I've learned, in a way, has situated my subjectivity as an intellectual in such a manner that I'm not able to articulate certain forms of knowledge, certain marginal knowledge. So, in terms of going forward, I think the question is about putting in place mechanisms that enable us to unlearn what the, you know, the habits
that we have. Lovely. I think that's probably a very appropriate moment at which to bear in mind the time. Return to the panel for any final thoughts or reflections in the light of the contributions from the floor, in some cases specific questions, and indeed whether what you've heard from other panelists on the floor has in any way caused you to rethink your opening positions. So literally 2 or 3 minutes each, please, either with that mic or up here.
What I had, in a way, confirmed what I was thinking. Firstly, I would agree with Lumi about the good and bad guys in the South and in the North. And there is something called privilege theory, because Comrade here was asking, you know, the new movements, what form should they take? So there's this idea that this mic cuts out, so I don't like it.
Okay, then I'll pop up here.
Yeah, so there's this idea that I think you would know about this, that only a black woman will know and struggle, you know, to liberate black women. So that position actually, it's a strategic cul-de-sac, you know, if you're an activist, because your job as an activist is to actually, you know, win more people to the struggle and to actually change those men, you know, and white people who might, you know, through maybe not knowing or their position, were not supportive of that strategy. So there is that, and I think that's part of the job of theoreticians, academics, you know, to interrogate, you know, the intellectual and theoretical bases and sources of some of the new separatist thinking. And then I'm happy that many people talk about, you know, the South and the North, you know, because in a way, countries like Greece, they are the South of Europe, you know, we know that. So it means that maybe we should define the South as everywhere where they are oppressed and exploited. Yeah. And then some of us who are, you know, maybe slightly privileged, middle class, you know, we should just throw in our support behind those who are oppressed and exploited, and then we'll qualify to be called the South. I think that is the only way. And then also, I'm intrigued because I was keeping this point back because I thought someone was going to say, hey, but I think I've had this idea of, you know, countries and economies which are backward, you know, moving forward, like China. Trotsky had this theory of uneven and combined development. Yeah. So it means that it is possible, actually, for so-called, you know, less developed countries. Hey, capitalism itself, it's the nature of capitalist development, it's uneven, you know, between branches of industry, between countries, between classes, you know, and sometimes a country will be bestowed, I don't know, by an act of God with resources, oil. You know, they've done nothing, but they will therefore, you know, occupy, you know, a better place in the race. So I'm just saying that we should go back to those theories and look at them. And then there's the problem of the resurgence of nationalism. Sometimes it takes the form of what I can call left reformism or populism. So, you know, this is something we have to engage with. And someone raised the question of modes of production, you know, a longer term view. There's work done by a guy called Jairus Banerjee, which helps us, liberates us from, you know, the distortion of Marxist theorization during under Stalinism, actually. Yeah. Where there was this idea that first there was the slave mode of production, then it was feudalism, then it was capitalism, and then for sure socialism will come. So actually, you know, there are multilinear, you know, historical developments. It's something we can interrogate because I've heard, you know, comrades, people, those black youth in South Africa, they say openly, no, Marxism is a European concept and theory, which, hey, you know, yeah, so maybe they just got, you know, a different and wrong version of Marxism, and we can win them over. Yeah, you know, they read a lot of Fanon, you know, but I'm sure Fanon read a lot of Marx, you know, so I don't know what's going on there. And then, my last point, I would have liked to address Leo's thing about movements, because, you know, what are the new strategies? But I just want to say that one of the problems we had, you know,
World Social Forum, even before that, was this, you know, ideas of autonomism, you know, against grand narrative, you know, every river must flow. But what we found was that, you know, there's an enemy out there, and it unites and smashes, just as happened with Greece, just as happening with many other struggles. So we too on the left, we too on the side of the oppressed and exploited, we must find ways of uniting, building bridges. And, you know, we're not always going to agree, but maybe use an old strategy, United Front. You know, we can march separately, but strike together. I think we can do that. Thank you.
Thank you. Just a very quick one from me. I think just picking up on Carol's question on why African scholars maybe don't pay attention to processes that are happening in their own backyard. I think throughout is something that is sort of coming out, that there are sort of internal habits that have been formed, orientations, and I think people have picked up on it, that sort of prevent people sometimes from realizing that what is being perpetuated. And I think what Trevor just said also is very true. There is a machinery out there that is also fighting the battle and sort of distracting attention from what might be the real issues towards a different way of thinking. I think there are many examples of where people would have maybe given their attention elsewhere and focused on, say, theory building from the South, thought about new methodologies and things like that. But because of the sort of power dynamics, the financial power dynamics, some of that is lost. So I think in going forward, again, for me, platforms such as these that allow us to interact and allow us to start networking and forming sort of alliances of good guys from the North and the South to start changing the way we are oriented, to start changing the way we perceive things. I think that's an important step in the right direction. I think just as a last point, sometimes it's like when you are going for a checkup and you do not know that you're not well, and then you go for your checkup and you get a battery of things that you realize you actually needed some interventions. So in that respect, I think it's important for all of us to relook at ourselves and always come for these checkups and figure out how to do things differently. Thank you.
I assume he's referring to a neoclassical health trend.
First, I failed to thank the sponsors for having this conference. This is really a great opportunity. It has been a wonderful opportunity not only to hear the presentations, but to interact with all the scholars and activists that are here. So I would hope that this is the first and of many. So thank you. I just have some like fleeting thoughts that comments that happened as a result of comments, thinking of Carol's comment, and it sort of ties into the idea that Africans are sitting on a gold mine. You know, for years, Africans have planted and walked through places, and then Europeans come and dig gold and make billions out of it. Those, you know, Africans were walking around and enjoying it, and they didn't know that there were diamonds and gold and uranium and platinum and cobalt right underneath their feet. And I think it's the same thing in terms of the intellectual knowledge, that Africans, there is a gold mine. There is a gold mine for you. So why aren't we mining that gold? You know, I was thinking, okay, well, one reason is that you don't know that it's there,
And I think the other is, it was brought up before, is I don't know about you, when I start figuring out what I want to study, you figure out who's funding it. So, you know, it's hard to do research on even important things if there's not someone who's providing the money. And if we don't have sources of funding that will fund the things that are not sexy or, you know, things that people aren't talking about, it is very, very difficult for any scholar to do important research if there's not funding. So I think that funding is continues to come in. And then there was another thought that came to me when the talk was, when the gentleman was talking about how the policy is often not set by the international community. It's often set by what happens locally. And I thought about this incident in Ghana, where Ghana was receiving aid, and they were receiving rice from the United States, and now the Ghanaians prefer Uncle Ben's rice. Why is that? Because the aid that was given them was Uncle Ben's rice. Now, Uncle Ben's is the preferred rice that they buy in Ghana. So here we have an economic policy being set by aid. And I don't think that's accidental. I think they understand that you can set economic policy through local intervention, and all of a sudden they're hooked. And now they prefer Uncle Ben's American rice as opposed to Ghanaian rice. Another quick one is this interesting, thank you, interesting book by the comment by the article by the Comaroffs. I thought was really good, and I appreciate your comments that the gentleman back there, that it has a lot of implications, not just north-south, and not just east-west. But maybe they're trying to inspire us to think about something even bigger than that. The concern I had when I read it was probably identified in this one sentence, and this is what it says. What follows is a reflection on the contemporary order of things approached from a primarily African vantage. I was thinking, I wonder if the African intellectuals would say that. I wonder if this vantage can be confirmed. I mean, they're saying that this is an African vantage. The question is, would the African intellectuals say that this is an African vantage? And I think sometimes we assume the authority to speak for the Africans. I can speak for the Africans because I've studied Africa. Well, would the African authorities say you can speak, that this is the African vantage? I think we need to just humble down and not assume that we have the ability to speak from the position of an African intellectual. I think that's one that sort of jarred me when I read that. And I'm like, okay, well, who are you? I know you have studied, but you're speaking for all the African intellectuals? And that caused me a little. And finally, I'm not sure what we should include in the curriculum, you know, but I think one that we better include is understanding globalization from the African perspective. Most of the globalization books are not written by African intellectuals, and I would like to see some sort of understanding of globalization and its impact on the African continent from the African perspective. So that's some work for you guys to do.
Thank you. Oh, yeah.
Not much to say, but except that I had the good guy from the good guys from the north and the good guys from the south. What I'm saying is, we can help make the difference together. Those good from the north, those good from the south, together we can help make and bring the change and set the agenda that is good for Africa.
Thank you.
Just a few points. I think that my advice would be that as scholars, we should be humble, you know. I think that none of us has the right answer, and I think that's the right approach. And that our approach to research should be rigorous, but open-minded. I don't think that problems, you know, come as a single story. You know, they are very complex, and they also don't come packaged in compartments as law, economics, that sort of thing. So, strong interdisciplinary approach is important. I think we shouldn't fall into this problem of thinking that, you know, we know the solution. That's what the IMF also thinks. So then you are just acting the same way. I think also we should not go into labeling. I think, as has been pointed out, in the diaspora, there are good people, there are bad people, there are bad scholars everywhere, even including black scholars. And also, I think we should not forget that conditions are continuously changing. You know, I think that the struggle has to be waged on several levels. As you're waging a struggle, there are also victims that you have to deal with. You know, and I think that you have to have policies for the longer term goal, but also to deal with the victims of the system as actually things are going on. Otherwise, you actually find yourself overtaken by events. Yeah, so I think the context is really very, very important. I think it's also very important, of course, to clarify the goal, where you're going, but also realize that, you know, it will take time. You might not reach there, but at least you're going there. I mean, that's the critical part. And I think the context, conditions are so different in terms of who would have imagined that, you know, the technological, you know, innovation that are today current in the 1950s world. So you have to take account of things as they move, and we have to adjust and respond to what is going on. But I think my really important message is that our problems are not single stories, and look at the context, and work with others. You know, and I think that the message that to me doesn't matter whether the person is black or white. I mean, I think the critical thing is really the rigor with which they apply and what they have to offer. Analyze what they have to offer, and be able to deal with it. What they're advocating, rather than simply dismiss somebody on the grounds that, oh, you know, they are from diaspora or whatever. And not everybody in diaspora is good. Thank you.
Very briefly, please, because people do need to catch taxis.
Yeah, I think two or three things. I think the one thing that I like most about it is that it concludes by saying there's much north in the south and much south in the north. Therefore, it's a very useful analytical lens to look at what we have been debating. In terms of the African University, I think it's time it needs to be overhauled. I think my own feeling is that the African universities have experienced a systematic growth, especially in terms of student numbers. So there's little intellectual activity taking place apart from teaching. So we need to look at that. In terms of what needs to be taught in Africa, I don't think we can specifically prescribe what needs to be taught, because I think drawing from the book, there are certain shared universalisms, whether you live in the South or in the so-called North. But what is important is customizing what you are teaching to the practical needs of your particular context. And finally, I think I would want to respond to the issue of small farmers. I think if indeed the Comaroffs are right, that the North is evolving towards the South, then one would argue that there are people in the North that people in the North are not just sitting back. Yeah, they would want to reclaim that process. And I think for me, this rings true, especially when we come to the subject of seeds. Yeah, you know as much as I do that as we speak, there is a G8 supported movement that is trying to modify our seeds all together. And I'm talking about the G8 New Alliance for Food Security and the nutrition, whose main weapon is the harmonization of seed at the regional level in terms of creating, I think, a bigger market for the players from the North. So I think what is important to realize that these are ongoing contestations, and we have to treat cases
on their own merit in the interest of the broader common good. Thank you.
Thank you.
My contribution would be, what other kinds of abstractions could we think through if we had to kind of imagine a theoretical perspective? The reason why I'm not a really big fan of the Comaroff's book, I have to admit, is that in the use of the analytical categories of north, south, and these kinds, it implies certain types of subjectivities, which I find quite problematic, and it kind of implies this schizophrenic split. So, you know, here I am, right? Grew up on the Copper Belt, underwent crisis, studied in South Africa, studied in Europe, who am I? And pretty much everybody sitting in this room has got multiple itineraries that make them and create them into kind of multiple subjectivity. And so one cannot, I do not believe that one can completely unlearn, but then how can we bring all of that together to kind of imagine how we might draw on all these multiple itineraries to create something new and interesting that links us all up in various interesting ways.
Brilliant, thank you. Well, I shan't attempt to sum up beyond saying the answer to the question who sets the agenda for African studies would appear to be all of us if only we could agree who we are, individually and collectively. So with that, the conference comes to a close, and we should end by thanking once again those we acknowledged right at the beginning, principally among the organizing committee, Lynn Shoemaker, who sadly isn't with us, and crucially Colin Stoneman, who quietly but very feverishly has been guiding us on our way and sorting out the financial and other logistics. And he was sitting right in the back, but he seems to have, he's around the corner. And of course, from SciPAR, Maya Hinfelar, Jessica Achberger, and the four wonderful women. So thank you all very much. We will put together